yeah, right.
Scott's thing was push this S so it ties to Dante, and then cover it around, and then continue it so that it goes here, and then add this so that it kind of brings it back up, and then I'll continue it with the smoke. So,
which was good because I always thought the smoke was kind of.
Anything better?
Sure.
All right, we are drawn to fantasy. We did it, Ange. Another week. It's the 15th. It is Draw Live by Request today, but it is also Dinosaur Day. That's Graham wearing a dinosaur outfit. That's his mask, Ange. That's what he wears. He'd have little tiny T-Rex arms. No one's ever drawn a dragon with tiny T-Rex arms. It'd be kind of funny, right?
Yeah, usually they don't have arms or they have arms.
Yeah, either the bat wings or they have...
Jason's doing mom, dad, is that you?
We're here. We did it.
Oh
my we finished
gosh.
Another week. It's May 15th, episode 46. It is going to turn into a Draw Live Bear request, but I don't remember who it was.
Sorry, we were talking about real work for a moment.
We are. Here, I'll show you.
We were talking about worky work.
I think you guys... Last week I was working on the... the art that's going to be the sleeve art for the Kenny and the Dragon box set. And I sat with my good friend Scott Fisher actually this morning. And Scott is so good with composition, as you know, Ange.
Yeah.
And Ange kept saying she was concerned about Graham's neck or lack thereof, that it seemed too much like he was just kind of peeking out. So
it was kind of like just a floating head on the wing.
Right. So I sat with Scott this morning and he and I kind of talked about it, and where we kind of landed was, and they're just minor tweaks. He had me have Kenny's, he didn't like that everything was kind of going straight across here, and he understood the whole thing that we were trying to do with the height, the different heights. So he's just like, I would have Kenny break the wings, and he was like, have Graham make it an S, so have that, get to see a little bit of that, and it's going to take you to Dante, and then you're going to have these arms that are going to create the same angle that's part of his neck, and then bring that S here, have it encompass Charlotte, and then, or I think I do, I actually enlarge Charlotte more, so she's actually breaking. I have Charlotte here now, Ange. That's where I'm thinking I'm going to put her. And then change Charlotte's tail, so here's tail one, tail two. Actually, hold on, I'll grab the tunnel. Probably easier to see it.
This week has been longer than a week. Grimnel, I agree.
Whoa, Grimnel, you haven't... It's
yes.
Surpassed. It's been... It's
what
like a lifetime.
What is going on with this week? It's bizarro.
So there was the tail. It was tucked behind here, and it was meant to mirror George's shield. So now we have the tail kind of continuing this whole shape. And what's it do? It's going to point right to the title of the book. We flipped Flitz, the narrator's tail, this way. So we're keeping that movement going. Now, it was too on the nose to have his tail going up, Ange. So instead I put the plume in his hand, his writing pen, and I'm going to have his little inkwell down next to him.
I love that because it needed something a little to fill it up a little more.
Yep. And then this goes to George, and then George, the shield's breaking the wing more, and I angled it a little bit. And I think the final thing I did, I shrunk Dante down just a little bit and moved him out a little bit so you just see a little more of him because he is a little hidden behind there. And then we changed the smoke. Where here the smoke was kind of just smoke. Now I'm starting to think about what's the role the smoke plays and how it also keeps your eye moving through the whole piece. So some real nice tweaks. I'll be working on it starting next.
It's going to look really great.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
So good. I like his scale being larger.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, in fact, Ange, that's what you didn't see. There's a version that's different than this where I enlarged the name thing even higher,
okay,
so that it's covering up here. And then I also slid George up and I slid Charlotte up. So it's the pieces are interlocking now. Yeah.
And you're going to paint all these separately.
We're going to paint it separate. I think I have to do it that way because I need the ability to shrink and move the stuff around. I don't want to be locked in. And I even went back to, I don't want to get too far off topic, but I went back, there's a section in the Drew Struzan Art Of book where he's doing the Adventures in Babysitting cover. Our poster, movie poster, and I don't know if you remember, that's Elizabeth Shue and the kids, and they're scaling down
side
a wall.
Of the building.
Yeah, the studio saw and said, we want the city to be a little higher, you know? And so he literally, there's a whole story that tells how he had to cut the art from the illustration board and peel it and then peel it. And then they had it, they had to make another change again. So even in the 80s, before Photoshop and you could do all that, a person like Drew Struzan would have done it on separate layers so that he could have that ability to move stuff around. So anyway, it's a long...
Did they go into Drew Struzan's place in...
Prop culture.
Yeah, in the show Prop Culture on Disney Plus. I just saw a hummingbird outside, I think.
Yeah, they're out. I could see them being out. We need to get a feeder. We don't have any flowers blooming.
That was awesome.
Yeah, little hummers are out there.
Sorry, guys. I got distracted. Hummingbirds are like my favorite bird.
Yeah, it's like your spirit animal.
I know. There's just something about flitting around all the time.
Yep.
Buzzing around.
Anyway, happy Friday. Glad you guys are here. And as we were requested to draw dinosaurs, I was going to pull some art from Dinosaur Summer. That's a book I did very early in my career. It was written by a very known award-winning science fiction author named Greg Bear. It's no longer in print, and it was a terrific project, but I didn't have time to get it all pulled out. But what I did is we talked a little bit about Charles Knight. I always pull those animal books. And this is a terrific book, Ange. It's the history of Charles Knight, but it's also Charles did a lot of dinosaur drawings. And now let me see if I can find some of those drawings for you, because these, I'm so old that these are the dinosaurs that I kind of grew up with, this era of the 1970s and 1980s depictions of dinosaurs, which we all know have changed a whole lot in the last 50 years. The depictions of dinosaurs and how dinosaurs...
Where's that mural at? I feel like I've seen that mural.
The Field Museum, Ange, is where we saw a lot of... In fact, I may have gotten this book when we went to the Field Museum last.
Okay.
So there you go. That gives you an idea. There's the Brontosaurus that I grew up with, and which has obviously changed many, many times. But, you know, the Charles Knight stuff is great. And in fact, Ange, there's a whole subculture now of people who collect retro, inaccurate dinosaur books from the 50s and 60s, which is kind of fun, where it just shows the, you know, there's a charm to these old dinosaur depictions.
Does that connect to the William Stout story, Steve Jankowicz?
Look at that. Right. On it. This book's a big, pivotal book in my life because as a kid who grew up loving dinosaurs by Charles Knight, the Bill Stout, there's a card by Bill, the Bill Stout, dinosaur book that came out in the late 80s. I was a senior in high school when I first discovered this book. And Bill Stout kind of did a couple things. I mean, one of the criticisms is his dinosaurs are really anorexic looking, which I understand. It's a fair criticism, but I think it's because Bill was paying such close attention to the skeletons and really just adding skin over these skeletons. But it's Bill's... taking his kind of almost comic book approach and theatrical approach to depicting dinosaurs. And also there's a bit of Mooka in here. I know that shows up. And there's a lot, like all the Rackham in that. There's a lot of Arthur Rackham in there. And that just, it was really exciting. It was just a really cool swirling vortex of amazing art style.
Comic-y at the same time.
Yeah, I love this piece. I love that piece.
Cool piece.
Yeah. And so... just a huge, I mean, there's also kind of a, almost like a frowdiness to it in a way. You can really see that kind of style.
Well, it's very illustrative.
This is an illustrator drawing dinosaurs, not a scientist drawing dinosaurs.
Right.
And I think that's what makes it so incredible. I really love the storytelling that's happening in this art. It was really, really influential on me as a young artist. So the Bill Stout dinosaur book's a big one.
And we'll tell the Bill Stout dinosaur story while you're drawing.
I got a couple more I just want to show because I think they're worth mentioning. And I feel like the fans of fantasy always like when I pull some books out of the old library. And this one I found at a nature company, so that gives you an idea how old this is. And
you're buying a rain stick and a rainforest soundtrack
to Tropical Thunderstorm.
Tropical
Thunderstorm CD. Mm. And when I first saw this book, I thought this was real, and I would go so far as to say this book is going to be influential on
the field guide,
on the Spiderwick field guide, because What it is Dougal Dixon. He did a couple books, and this was one of them. I thought these were literally all new dinosaurs that had been discovered that I just didn't know about. And it turns out Dougal Dixon created his own field guide of new dinosaurs. Like, how cool is that? That thing is amazing. So this absolutely affects. Look at the movement lines. I did that with the gargoyles in the Spiderwick Field Guide, the kind of the animated movement to show the kind of, oh my God, I just loved this book so much. So huge in like just opening my brain on how.
Oh my gosh, it's hilarious. It's like so mashup.
It's so magic, so Muppety.
Like
so Muppety. Like there's imagination at work here, but there's some beautiful drawing that's also happening in there. It wouldn't surprise me if Dougal Dixon came from animation. I actually don't know a lot about his background, but there's so much movement in these that it wouldn't surprise me. And this reminded me of so much of some of the fantasy books that I would make in my, you know, as a teenager of lost islands full of monsters. And all of this fuels, of course, the Spiderwick Field Guide and the Spiderwick Chronicles. So now we're going to jump. And on that note, one final book. This book is really terrific in that this is a newer one. This is closer to our decade than these other examples I've shown you. This came out in, well, it's got... Why can't I find a date? Anyway, it's new. Sorry, I can't be more... Anyway, what this was they took artists and they talk about the old depictions of dinosaurs. And so what they wanted to do was have modern day artists take the information and reinterpret it. And, you know, what would they come up with today using... just the skeleton, which is what I'm going to use today. And then how would they depict how these animals may have looked, which is kind of the fascination with dinosaurs is we don't know.
I don't know what was in that sofa. That was amazing.
What's that?
Sofa just made, what is, the, come tell me.
Okay, so it's
come
a,
over here, come here.
Ow, my foot. It's a marshmallow cream that you drizzle on top of Rice Krispie Treats.
Yeah, it is.
And it's marshmallow that you, so you take like a tablespoon of water, you put in one marshmallow in a microwavable bowl, you microwave it, and you stir it together, and then you take it out, you add a drop, like a few drops of vanilla extract, and then you add a little bit of powdered sugar to make it like a little bit firmer, and then you stir it together, and then you put one more marshmallow in, you put it in the microwave, like in the bowl, and you put it in the microwave, and then you stir it together, and then you take the whisk and you whisk it to get all the chunks out.
It's
very
delicious.
Cool. Very cool.
It's
awesome.
Delicious. So
well, I'd love one too. I'm good, so. All right, so back to dinosaurs. Again, you can just see here, here's the skeleton. You know, he's added, the artist has added, you know, fat and things like that. I think my favorite one was the one on the cover of the book where they kind of take the idea of like the goats that climb trees. Anyway, I'm going to use something like that in my approach to drawing dinosaurs today. I've got an old book. It's an Encyclopedia of Dinosaurs, but it has skeletons, and that's all I'm going to use as my inspiration. We'll go from there. Now, so I don't know if anyone has, I'm going to start with a theropod. Those are the bird-like dinosaurs. And then we'll go from there, Ange.
Awesome.
And our drawing, our daily dinosaur drawing. Actually, you know what? I do love a ceratopsian. Let's try it. I've got these ceratops. There's a triceratops. That's a pretty classic dinosaur. I have always thought of these. I always think of parrots with these beaks that are made to shear off things. So I'm going to try a very parrot-like.
Steve Jankowitz hates dinosaurs with feathers.
He hates dinosaurs with feathers. Like, you really honestly do, or you just, it's
no,
destroyed.
He said it. I still hate dinosaurs with feathers.
Oh my God. I think they were all covered in stuff. I think we're going to find out that they had some kind of down or something. Jim Gurney and I kind of got into this a little bit where years ago, he wanted me to, we kind of exchanged fan art. He had done a Spiderwick drawing for that collection we did, Ange.
Mm-hmm.
And in return, he asked if I would do a drawing from Dinotopia, and I did Bix is the Protoceratops. That's kind of the main character in his series. And I drew him like a parrot, just covered in bright feathers. And he's like, oh, that's fanciful. And I'm like, you know, I mean, listen, you know more than the average human about dinosaurs, no question. But, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if these things were covered in some kind of fur or down. I think to survive for as long as they have.
Gators aren't and stuff.
Right, but gators are also limited in where they can live in the world. Alligator couldn't live up here.
Right.
Because the winter would kill it.
True.
Now, it was warmer. I mean, and when I say warmer, I mean, we're also talking about a span of millions and millions of years. So I'm sure there were periods where it was cold, you know, it was warmer than yours and colder and stuff. But I know they found skin impressions, and I think, I don't know if we'll see it in our lifetime, but I suspect we'll get computer models based on DNA that really show what these things looked like, and I wouldn't be surprised if there's fur and stuff on them. So I'm also thinking of a rhino horn, Ange, would only have, it's like our fingernail, you know, you have the bone, but then there's the keratin over it. So I'm guessing the horns on these things were probably, you know, just nuts, and probably had like...
What year is the Dixon book, Heidi wanted to know?
Oh, let me look, Heidi. I don't know if it's in print any longer. I hope it is.
Dinos are birds, not reptiles.
1988. So it may still be in print. I know all yesterday's I bought within the last few years. I don't have any...
Eric Berger, parrot. Here doesn't love the land before time. Eric Berger.
Oh my gosh. Really, for me it was 1 million year BC. That was definitely the big and then the Harryhausen movies.
I feel like now that I'm having this conversation for some reason, I feel like Drawn to Fantasy could be like a Netflix show. And you're the host, T. You're like the you know, what's his name? David Attenborough.
Okay.
But you're like, instead, you're like going through nature, and then you're like, let's draw it.
Yeah.
That's just my vision.
I like that.
It's just, I think that would be...
I actually thought about a show that was like a very short, almost, you know how Jerry Seinfeld has the getting cups of coffee thing?
Yeah.
I wondered about a show where an artist that can speak artist, children's books, goes and visits different children's book artists in their studio, so in their space, and talks a little bit about their career and then their philosophies of making books for children. I think that would be kind of interesting.
You can make art, but you want to see the art making art part.
Yeah, well, yeah, that would be definitely a segment, would be that part. I don't know. I just thought that would be really cool. And then I think about that.
But do you want to host it?
Yeah, I want to do the whole thing. Like, I'd be the one that's like, all right, today I'm going
Fantasy Tiger King.
Right. Oh, my gosh. But then I think about it, and then I go, I'm going to go make books and go draw and paint myself. Like,
It's just something cool to do. I mean, that's the thing, is we're always up for trying new stuff, I feel like. And we're like, oh, that's cool. We make books. That's what we do. And then we have a little, we head off of the path for a little bit and then go make something else cool.
Yeah.
Create something else.
I don't know. It's interesting.
Kevin, right? Sylvester said, have I mentioned I was a radio announcer for 15 years?
Oh my gosh, we got to hear
it. Why are you not doing, you should be totally doing some voiceover stuff, Kevin. You should be, you could just take, here's what I think. I think there should be videos of people doing things, because I keep driving around town and seeing people do things socially distanced. And I think it would be really interesting to have it looks like a nature show, it's narrated like a nature show.
That would be amazing.
Right?
Yeah, that'd be amazing.
But it's all of the things that people are doing while they're in quarantine.
Some have decided to venture forth from their domiciles.
Right, exactly. Let's
see what they're doing. Now, I don't have a parrot. I wish I had a parrot reference. I'm going to grab one, Ange.
Take a question. I'll be right back. I think I got some parrot reference.
Ooh, looking at parrot reference. Okay, so
I need a parrot
reference. So if you guys have questions in the meantime, I'm here hanging out. Today, frankly, not a super, super duper productive day. My brain is not in productive mode. I think I just needed a little quiet day. I've realized in this, I have not had, and I don't know if you guys have had, yes, I did see the Absurd Planet on Netflix. I have not kind of given myself that day where I just totally veg out and watch bad TV and kind of have a moment. Like, I think we've been so focused on being productive and making stuff and doing things that I haven't actually said, you know what, it's okay to take a little break.
Yeah, I'm definitely with you on that.
What was the first
look at that
book that Tony showed?
Look at, so here, look. Look at those skulls, Ange. Look at this. Do you know what I mean? Like, you can
see the beak and the head.
Yeah, I think.
The eye.
I mean, what if this whole thing, you know, what if, and it may not have been the whole body was covered in feathers. It could have been that just the head was like a frill. It could, and it could have been feathers that they loot. Like, during mating season, it looks like this. And then during the rest of the year, you know, it looks like a dinosaur. You know, the typical depiction of a dinosaur.
What was the book you said that was being done by the Norman Rockwell Museum?
Oh, yeah, we didn't talk about that. I'm not prepared. Okay. Let's talk about it Monday. And the book's not out yet. So let's talk about it Monday. I'm going to make a note of it right now. Let me grab a stickum. And we'll talk about it Monday. Oh, not Monday. Friday. Because we're going to Fridays, right?
Oh, are we?
We're going to Fridays.
Are we making it official?
I think we
but
need
do
to
we want it to be Fridays?
Well, make it any day you want.
Like maybe it's Thursdays. Maybe it's, hold on, I gotta check and see. I know I've got events next week. Let's check.
Yeah, I think we're gonna go to one day a week starting next week, guys. We are, I feel like the world is, right now at least, is kind of beginning to move on. So I'm thinking.
You know, we just dropped that on you guys.
No, we've been talking about it all week.
I know we've been talking about it.
I mean, maybe we'll think about it over the weekend, and you'll change your mind. But I mean,
it's not my mind.
My mind.
It's not my mind. I think what it is we've had a lot of actual work happening.
Yeah, but I'm happy to share that. I don't mind sharing that. You know what I mean? Like, I'm fine sharing whatever I'm working on. Because I'm just going to be painting. I just think there's going to be repeat. That's the truth of it. That's the reality, right? You're going to see the same, oh, look, he's painting again. Well, that's...
Well, I don't even think it's that. I mean, I listen to podcasts, and I listen to radio interviews, and it's the same people talking, and I really, really enjoy it.
Okay.
So I don't think it has to do with repetitive material. I don't think I'm like, oh, there he is. Drawing again. You're drawing something else. You know, that's the other thing.
Yeah. I'm on Kenny and the Dragon though for another month, doing all the promo stuff.
I know. We don't want to disappoint anyone. Sorry to hear you guys are bummed. We don't know what day we're going to cut back to. We haven't actually had this conversation. We've been talking about it, like cutting back, but we haven't talked about what the specifics are going to be. And the other thing is, Soph's got 2 weeks of school left.
Yeah.
So now we're thinking about what is that going to look like when she's not in school.
Yep.
And as you guys know, she's pretty self-sufficient. She's upstairs, you know, making Rice Krispie treats right now. And
I know she wants to draw. She's talked about doing it.
But I also think we can, like, pop on, and it's the kind of thing that you can announce on your page and say you're going to go live tomorrow at this time.
Yeah.
And we can post that to Draw Into Fantasy, so you guys will all be in the loop on it. Yeah.
I don't know. That's what we're just kind of thinking about that. I'm trying to figure out how the feathers would go. I'm looking at a macaw, and it's definitely a lot of skin, and then it's feathers, and then it's like, it'd be really interesting if what if it had these?
Man, Elisa's got a big, can you do a cross between a T-Rex, a wolf, a rhino, and a tiger?
No, but you can. That's a very specific, request. I think that's you. That's you, Lisa.
So let's be real. You're not really doing Drawn by Request right now. The request was for you to do dinosaurs.
Yeah. I'm doing a dinosaur. I mean, we can do, you know, I can do a few more dinosaurs, or we can keep the whole thing themed on dinosaurs. I kind of, you know, I don't care. Or we can, you know, I can do this one dinosaur, and then we can kind of move past it and get on to something else.
Vicky Lee said, I'm surprised you've kept up daily so long.
You know, there's days, like I have said this before, there's days I feel like doing it. And aside from earlier this week where Carolyn Reedy passed away, you know, I've had the gas in my tank to do it. But I just feel like right now, I think people are going to start becoming more and more involved with as they get back to work and things like that. But you know what? Look, if a week goes...
Yeah, you guys should absolutely... Joanne Lone said, we're keeping the Drawn to Fantasy group, right? Absolutely, you guys should keep that.
Yeah.
It's been awesome. And I don't think... Listen, I don't think it's going to go away 100%. I don't think... I just think it's the predictability of 5 days a week at 3 p.m.
Yeah.
That, you know, we might be like, okay, we're going to pop on at 7, or let's go on at 11.
Earlier, yeah.
Yeah.
And that could be, which I'm sure you probably don't like either, because then now you don't know when to
now
tune in.
Now you don't know. But we can post when we're going to be on, even like the day before, just to...
Yeah. Or, you know, and or it's...
Or you're just painting and you just set up your live.
Yeah. Or it's well, yeah, there's that. And then the other option would be it's... ooh, that'd be kind of... See, I like that. But see, like right now I'm not working, which I don't mind. I'm definitely one who will goof off.
Yeah.
Yeah. What if they had?
And you love to sketch. I mean, you're sketching, but yeah, you're not sitting down and writing.
I'm not writing. I'm not. You know.
You're not saying that you're not painting on your. You could have been painting on the Kenny and the Dragon.
I would. See, there's the thing. Because the way the day came out, you saw. I literally was just printing out all the things to size, and I would be tracing right now. That's all I'd be doing is cutting paper, and tracing. Very exciting stuff.
24-hour live cam.
Yeah.
Reality TV. Tony D. DiTerlizzi TV.
Oh man, you just see a grown man more than you need to, just picking his nose and his ear and looking at drawings, and you know the way my brain kind of works. I get excited about something, so often I'll set my tools down and I'll run off and go, you know, look up a thing. I watched the other day while you guys were out delivering.
You guys should stream. I wonder if you can do live on the Drawn to Fantasy fan page.
Yeah. Well, on top of that, all the videos we have recorded are all archived on the website too. I mean, it's not like anything's gone away there. But I watched this documentary on two of the Disney's nine old men, Frank Thomas and Ollie Johnston, and they were just such unbelievably talented and terrific guys. They've been friends since art school. They've been through everything together. It's pretty amazing documentary. It's an older one, but I had just never seen it. It's on Disney Plus if you have it. And so that sent me on a whole, you know, mission. I was like, oh my gosh, I got to go look up more art by these individuals, because I was just so inspired by the work, and particularly Frank Thomas was showing off these drawings he had done for Bambi. And I'm like a moderate, I'm not a huge fan of Bambi. I mean, it's good. It's the animation's beautiful. I really love the background. The watercolor background paintings are just beautiful. But when I looked at that, at Frank's pencil sketches or Conte, I don't even know what he did them in. I got to do a little homework. They were so lively and so amazing. I just was so inspired to like hunt them down. And there's beautiful high res scans out there on the internet. So I was out kind of chasing scans, chasing images.
How do you transfer drawings to the board?
This right here. This is a light table I'm working on. So all I'll do is put the board over it and go to town. And that's it. The board's thin enough that I can do that. I won't get a super tight, clean trace, which is good because it'll force me to redraw the image, which we've talked about before. I don't know. What do you think, Ange? Kind of cool, right?
It's cool.
Kind of like a parrot parody.
What's your favorite dinosaur?
Ooh, long before Jurassic Park, I was a huge fan of Deinonychus, which is kind of the prototype of the velociraptors in Jurassic Park. See, I'm wondering if it just had like this downy. I could see it with almost like these, almost like a kiwi. Just this kind of... Or a emu. I could see it with these kind of feathers. I could see it. And maybe it's like an ostrich where the neck and the throat are bare. Or the neck and the throat could have been really bright, you know, like a booby bird where it just had a ton of color.
Lisa said, how would you color it?
Like if I was going to a final illustration, I'd probably just paint it. I'd figure it all out in... probably in Photoshop first, but anyway, there's one dinosaur. We'll do one more, and then I'll just, hopefully you guys are enjoying this. I hope so. I certainly have. There's kind of that's a Centrosaurus.
Ooh, is that part of the junk pot?
Could be. It could be. Leif Odie's getting the, Pippin is the kobold watch. Look out.
And I was laughing because right after we finished up yesterday, Pippin was in the exact same pose
that
him in. He ran up to the window and was looking out.
Nice. Ooh, these are cool too. The ones that ram their heads together,
Pachycephalosaurs.
They're weird. That's kind of fun.
Very goat-like how they would like.
Yeah, but again, there are lizards. Very lizardy like head. Like a monitor lizard almost. The other thought is I think there's a bird that has like a big, lumpy, large head. I'm trying to think of what it's called. And I don't think every dinosaur, I mean, I'm looking at an ankylosaur. They were probably more like an alligator. I could see them that they were probably just scales and so on and so forth.
Topher has a question.
Topher Bradfield?
Yes.
Topher.
Hey, Topher.
How you doing?
He said, do you remember the first time you saw an artist rendering of a dinosaur with crazy bright colors?
I don't know if William Stout has that. I feel like his are all earthy colors. I would say Wayne Barlow, maybe? Maybe Wayne Barlow? I feel like he did a dinosaur book, too, that might have had bright colors. Or National Geographic. And again, I don't think they all have bright colors. I think some do. But when you look at, like, I think it's as diverse as birds. You know what I mean? You have birds that are brown and match their surroundings. And you have birds that have really bright plumage. And, you know, I am looking at a... Parasaurolophus, and that is pretty awesome. They've done quite a bit of research on this one, Ange. They actually recreated this nasal cavity thing on its head, the crest, and they like made a mold of it or something, and then they blew in it, and it made kind of a boom, and they wondered if that was like what the call of this dinosaur was this kind of honking. Yeah, probably real super low frequency stuff. Mm-hmm. I'm going to guess too, probably a very complicated my brain's synapsing here. A very complicated vocabulary of communication, probably more than we realize.
Ooh. Giant sloth, full skeleton of the giant sloth. Very cool. A little cave that had it. That is super cool.
Love that. Love the megatherium.
Yep.
Yeah.
So cool.
This.
Did we see those? Did they have those at the?
They have them right here in Amherst at the whatchamacallit museum.
Yeah. At UMass.
Yeah.
But there was, yeah, I remember seeing it there. But did they have one? At the tar pits or something? I feel like...
Yeah.
At the tar pits. Yeah, the La Brea tar pits.
Here's some fun.
I'm a giant sloth, Eduardo said. Yeah, I'm feeling like a giant sloth today, too.
This Parasaurolophus just triggered something. Now, this is a sketchbook I probably haven't looked at in 100 years.
That's a very long time.
It's a long time. This is my preparatory sketchbook for Dinosaur Summer. So I went to the Museum of Natural History in 1996. And I'm doing drawings from the animals on toned paper. And boom, I knew it. That's it, like triggered drawing the skull made me think of these duck-billed dinosaurs. So I would stand in the museum and I'm drawing the skulls from life. And then just trying, so you could see all the skull structure here and stuff. And then trying to figure out, like, how to skin it. There you go. There's this one had, they had a little skin impression on that. So here's some dinosaur drawings. There's an Allosaurus skull. This is a Bob Bakker drawing. And then I painted on top of his drawing. Here's some T-Rexes. This is, and then starting to think about, this was early on, just thinking about scenes. But even there, look, you can see I'm thinking of them like birds.
What year was this?
1996.
Whoa.
Oviraptor. Thinking of it like a, totally like a, just a bird. These dimorphodons were the inspiration for the tern fins. It's kind of cool. Yeah, I've not looked at this. I couldn't even tell you. It's been so long.
4 years ago.
So Archaeopteryx, I looked at Hoatzins. Anyway, I could go on and on. But, here's some bonus dinosaur stuff for you to see. Oh, this, it gets good at the end here. Hold on. This, I remember that. That's approximately actual size. So here's my hand. I remember just drawing that skeleton. The fossil was so delicate, Ange. It was just such a beautiful, tiny thing. It was amazing that it had been preserved. And I tried to draw it as close to actual size. And then, of course, next to it was a pteranodon. Here's another one drawn actual size. And then here I went home and started...
Did you airbrush on that?
Yeah, I put a little airbrush. Just started painting on it. I'm getting a little hearts on this. Yeah, I love the pterosaurs are like a separate
species.
It's just
a 24-year-old sketchbook.
Yeah, it's just a... I'm going to tell you right here what kind of sketchbook it is. It was made in New Jersey. It's just toned paper. It's just really heavy toned paper. Yeah, it's got all the Dinosaur Summer preparatory sketches are in it. There they are. There you go. Brown pelican dinosaur. Anyway, a little bonus dinosaur fun for you guys today. It's something I don't normally talk about or draw much anymore. I do have some stories that I've thought about with dinosaurs in them, but have never gotten my act together enough to get them going. Anyway, I'll do one more, and then we can take requests or whatever, Angie, if you want.
Cool. Let's see. I like your sketchbook. Do you watch Dino Dan?
I don't.
What's Dino Dan?
What's Dino Dan? That's going to be a negatory, because I don't even know what Dino Dan is. I loved walking with dinosaurs. I mean, I own them on DVD. I loved them so much. And the... Every incarnation of that show, the walking with prehistoric animals and all the other things that kind of went with it.
Dean Baxendale. I'll be honest, I've been coming here every day thinking Tony was going to teach me how to cook a roast.
Roasted dinosaur. Roasted Parasaurolophus.
Oh, you guys are all, now we got, they're tracking down Dinosaur Summer.
Oh, are they?
Dinosaur Summer
was Bill Stout.
Exactly.
Was supposed to do it. It sounds
let's
like
tell the Bill Stout story.
Bill Stout story. That's a pretty good story. So Bill Stout was originally approached to do Dinosaur Summer. I'd grab a copy of it, but I don't think there's one down here in the studio, Ange. I think it's up in the library, so
yep.
It's not worth grabbing right now. But and Bill.
Was it only in paperback?
No, it was in hardback.
It was in hardcover?
Yeah, it was in hardcover when it first came out.
Okay.
And Bill was asked to do it, and he couldn't do it. He was working on, he was working on a movie at the time. And so he recommended me for the job.
Which was so awesome, because yeah. You were a young kid illustrator.
Trying to break in. We were living in New York at the time, and I was definitely, like, pounding the pavement, trying to get work as an illustrator, and it was not easy. I remember it was really testing my resolve. Anyway,
definitely needed to get some money because we were paying to live in New York City.
Oh yeah, I was doing magic cards I was doing a lot of Magic the Gathering cards
and getting like the year's worth of rejections in the children's publishing industry.
Totally, yeah, that was definitely happening at that then, and but the reason Bill suggested me was because we'd spent some time together. Now, I'd written to Bill Stout. Out of art school, I think, maybe, Ange. I think I wrote him and had started kind of corresponding with him almost as a pen pal. And he was just so open
in
letters. And I've got those letters here. Not a lot. Postcard here, letter there, you know, just kind of back and forth. And we talked about Tori Amos a few weeks ago or last week. And Bill was a big Kate Bush fan. He's older than I am. He's a generation older. So he was like, "Oh, she just sounds like Kate Bush," and I hadn't really listened to a lot of Kate Bush. So he made me like, I have a mixed tape here somewhere that Bill Stout sent me of Kate Bush, which was pretty cool.
Steve Jankowitz, were you there when we were talking with him at Comic Con? That's funny. He said, "Sorry if I messed up your time with him at Comic Con."
Oh no. Well, we go and see him every year at any year we're at Comic Con, we always spend time together and catch up, because he really knew me so early in my career. I mean, he met me in Florida. He met both of us in Florida.
So you were doing Dungeons and Dragons work.
I just started, yeah. So we were corresponding, and he says to me at one point, "I'm coming to Florida for a comic book convention. And do you know any..."
I will also say, you guys aren't like friends at this point. You just corresponded and you had never met.
No, we corresponded. Maybe talked on the phone.
Yeah.
There might have been like, "Hey, can you give me a call?" That might have been how it started. Yep. And so I called him and he said, "I'm coming to Florida and for a comic book convention. And do you know..." And he was in Orlando. He was in Central Florida. So he's about 2 hours north of where we were living at the time in Jupiter. And he was like, "Do you know of any pristine places I could go draw environments?" Prehistoric is basically what he wanted. He wanted areas that were still swampy and untouched by humans that would have looked like the landscape in certain parts of North America during the Age of the Dinosaurs. And I said, "I don't know any areas up by you or up by Orlando, but I know all the areas in Jupiter." And he said, "Well, how far is Jupiter?" And I said, "About 2 hours." And he said, "Are you coming to the convention?" And I said, "Yeah, we were planning on it. We're going to come up and say hi and meet you." And he said, "Would you mind if we went to Jupiter and you showed me these places?" Which is crazy. Now that I'm saying those words, because I would probably never say that to someone.
Wait, and I can just crash at your house for a night.
Yes, and then just show me. So Ange and I drive up, we meet him, we talk, he finishes up the convention.
And let's also say, you haven't spent time at this point with really any of your...
artist
heroes whose work is so greatly admired.
No, not at all.
Like, it would be like, you're just reaching out, you're corresponding, here we are talking on the internet, and then Tony's like, "Hey, can I crash at your house?"
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, pretty much. Now, I did it early on in my career. I definitely remember crashing at some fans' houses, and it's not that I regretted it, but
there is one you regret.
Yeah, there's always a couple where you're just like, I don't think I'm Bill Stout. I don't think I can quite do what he's able to do. Anyway,
so we go.
We go and we bring him back. We bring him back to
also preface this by, first we hung out in Orlando.
Yep.
After the con.
Yep.
And then we went to dinner at this amazing place that is no longer open.
Oh, yeah. What was that place called?
It was called The Bubble Room.
Yes.
And it was this insanely themed out restaurant. And if you ever watched the movie Problem Child.
Because who's not watching that?
It was Problem Child or Problem Child 2, where they go to this restaurant and they have a huge food fight. It's almost like if you were eating in Pee Wee Herman's house in Pee Wee's Big Adventure.
Yeah.
Like, it is nuts. There is stuff everywhere. There's miniatures. There's trains. There was...
It was like plastered with toys and board games.
Yep. Stuff.
Ange, weren't the tables like resin and then they were filled with stuff?
Yep, the tables were resin and then they had like toys in the tables, but then they would have like a tunnel of love themed table. Like the theme, they were all different themed rooms. There was a jungle room. It is crazy. In fact, yeah, it is Problem Child too. Thanks, Max. So we go, and he invites us. We're like, oh, let's go to dinner. He's like, I'm going to bring my friend, Sergio Argonis.
Oh my God, you remember, see, this is gone. Like, you're really? Saying it. You're saying it now,
you
and I remember it now as you're saying it. But I wouldn't even have gone there in the story because I've forgotten.
Sergio Argonis, Sergio is
the creator of Mad Magazine.
I don't know if he was the creator. I know he's one of the.
No,
artists.
That's what's no, his face.
He's one of the artists from Mad Magazine. This guy's like legendary. If you guys know Sergio's work, the four of us go to dinner. I'm 20 years old. Tony's 24. We're a couple of kids at this point hanging out with these, you know, and they're just
legends.
Talking, like legendary artists. And I really didn't know a whole lot about this because I was indoctrinated into the world of illustrators from Tony, but I knew this meant a lot to him. And above all of that, these two guys were so cool. Yes, Gru, exactly, Mark.
Gru, thank you.
Sergio was amazing and hilarious and so warm and so funny and
I'm looking at that.
And Bill was just so cool and we're all sharing stories. But the cool thing was it wasn't like, hey, we're the old guys who are signing at a con and everyone's been waiting in line for us. It was just like having a conversation with people that felt like they had been your friends forever.
Yeah, they were very warm.
And then so that night, we're driving back in the car. We're in the back of like Tony's like crappy Prelude at the time, driving back to our apartment. And Bill Stout, and by the way, we didn't have a guest room.
No, we had a couch.
We had a two-bedroom apartment.
One bedroom is a studio.
That's right.
Where I'm drawing Planescape and Dungeons & Dragons.
Yep. And we wake up in the morning, Tony and I wake up early, and Bill Stout's asleep on our sofa.
That's the thing. He was like, we're getting up at like 5 o'clock. I want to get up before the sun comes up because I want to see the birds and everything too.
So he's sleeping. Bill Stout is sleeping on our sofa, and Tony and I are like two kids on Christmas Day peeking down from the stairway, and I remember looking at you, and I was like, Tony, Bill Stout sleeping on our sofa. And you're like, this is insane.
Yeah.
Like, you were freaking out.
So freaked out, guys. So
and
freaked out.
We stayed
out.
Up super late that night. Even when we came back, we didn't go right to bed.
No, we were looking at books and talking art.
Books, and he gave you a print.
Talking Rackham.
And it was so, so, so cool.
It was really, really. It's really amazing. And we did. So I took him to a ton of we packed the day. I took him to the.
It was not creepy. Penny said it sounds cute and a little bit. It wasn't creepy, though. It was more just like.
Well, I feel like he and I went for a big part of the first part of the morning. Like, you had to work, I think. Because I remember going to get breakfast with him, and it was on the go. We literally went to, like, a Dunkin' Donuts, grabbed breakfast, and then went hiking.
Yeah, you guys went early.
And then he and I grabbed you at one point because we all end up going canoeing up the Loxahatchee River, and he is like in heaven. He loved it. Thank God, right? Like, thank God the weather was agreeable and everything worked out because I was so scared that, like, it was going to be a classic Florida rainy, you know, crappy day. But
he loved it. This is what I'm saying. So, do you spend one night or two nights?
One night. We had to drive him back. I was exhausted because we ended up spending the night in Orlando because we were too tired to go home, to turn around and drive 2 hours back. So we spent the night. I remember this because the Academy Awards were on, and we were talking about it on the car ride up.
But don't you remember sitting in your studio on the floor?
Yes, I know where you're going. And then the story, the bit of advice that I carry in my pocket.
You want to know why we go and visit Bill Stout every single time we go to Comic-Con?
This is why.
This conversation.
Coming up. So we're talking, and we're talking about Star Wars, and we're talking about Jim Henson, and he had worked with all of these people. He knew George Lucas very well. He had worked, I think, on Willow, might have been the movie he worked on, or something. But he had done work, and I think he had done some work on Star Wars. And
he's worked on
so many movies, and he knew all these people, and he knew all the art directors, and he knew. You know, everything. And I remember saying to him, he was looking at my art, and it would have just been Planescape art and maybe some early children's book sample art, right?
But I want to also say this. You didn't want anything from him.
No.
You weren't like, oh, can I get some names of art directors? Never once did you ask him for anything. It was just about the experience of sharing time together.
Yeah, talking about Rackham and he's a huge Harry Rowntree nut.
Oh, no.
Even to this day, if I see Harry Rowntree art come up in auction or something, I'll email it to him and tell him, here's another one for your collection. Just a really terrific human being. And so he says to me, now, God, this is early, this has got to be 94 inch, 94, 95. I'm sure we could figure it out. Anyway, he says, I hear. They might be George is talking about making new Star Wars movies.
I think it's 94.
And I said, what? He goes, yeah. Now, guys, think about that. Go back to 1994, those of us who were old enough, and the concept of a new Star Wars movie was so, what? They're not done? You know what I mean? There'd only been those three movies. They would have been they wouldn't even be available on DVD yet. They would have been on VHS at that point. And for less, or just about maybe 10 years. So the idea of something new was just absolutely nuts.
Here's the other, I want to also say, we're in your studio at this point.
He's looking at everything.
He's looking at all your work.
Yeah.
Now, I know a lot of artists who are older, established, successful artists that would probably be with a 24-year-old, young, upcoming guy, look at your portfolio and go, uh-huh. And then spend the rest of the time talking about themselves. Right. Frankly. Like, yeah. There's a lot, I feel like, and you would have just eaten it up. You would have been like, I'm here to listen to everything, right?
Yeah.
But he wasn't. He was looking over all your artwork and so thoughtfully considering all of it and giving feedback and just.
I mean, he could have been talking about himself. I wouldn't have known.
No. No, I remember being in there and just thinking how generous he was.
So generous. But I think to his end, he was thinking, hey, these people are putting me up and they're showing me around, and you know, I'm going to get some cool reference of dinosaur stuff. Like maybe for him, you know, I don't know. You know, that knowledge and experience was something, it's no different than I guess you and I just doing this here and telling, not just telling stories, but also like, here's how you draw this, or here's what I look at when I do this. He just kind of gives it freely, not realizing that it's a huge commodity that he's sharing, right? So the night wanes on and he's telling me about that. And I say to Bill, I say, man, I would love to go work on the new Star Wars.
No, he was looking at your puppets, and we were talking about going to New York.
That's what it was. See, this is like, we need to record this stuff. I guess we are recording.
No, so one of the things is Tony. I mean, obviously, hugely influenced by Henson. Jim Henson as well. And you had made a lot of homemade puppets.
But yeah, I was playing with like learning how to cast latex
and foam rubber
because I wanted to really understand.
And you had new Muppet designs that you were working on because you were having conversations
with
Michael Frith.
At the Henson. That's another story. We'll save that for next week, the whole Henson stories. So I was like, you know, could I, because he was kind of looking at my art and saying, and my puppets and everything, and kind of taking everything in. He's looking at my drawings. He's looking at my books. He's looking at what I love. And he's looking at the puppets. And I think he's processing everything. And he's trying to figure me out. And I say to him, we must have been planning on moving to New York then at that point and going to, because I'm like, I would love to.
You're like, I'm going. I'm submitting my stuff.
I want to be like Brian Froud, and I want to work for the Henson Company, and I want to. You know, or I would go, I would love to work for Disney, or I would love to work for for George Lucas, and he goes, Tony, do you know how many George Lucases work for George Lucas? Do you know how many Jim Hensons worked for Jim Henson? Or how many Walt Disneys worked for Walt? You don't need to go work for those people. You need to go be one of those people. And I never looked back. And I'm indebted to him forever for steering my life. It's just a tap in your life. And it just sent me on another path. And the path I was on would have been a great path. But how much does it influence me? TSR wants to hire me as a staff artist. And Angie and I talk about it, and we turn that down. And then by the time we got to New York, the opportunities at Henson actually had evaporated. Because Michael, the short of the story was I'd been corresponding with Michael Frith, who had worked with Jim for many, many years, and was also an assistant to Dr. Seuss, just another terrific human being. And he had said, if you ever move to New York City, call us and we'll hire you to as a freelancer to work. And I called him. We probably weren't even in New York a week or two. And Andrew's like, you better call him. So I call him and he goes, oh my God, I'm so glad I get to talk to you. I'm retiring. He retired. We moved to the entire thing of moving to New York going, I think I could get work at Jim Henson's company.
And it was crazy. I mean, we went in. You're walking into the brownstone.
Right? Yeah, that they don't even own anymore. That was gone. Yeah.
And you walk in, and you're seeing Fraggles, and you're seeing the office that you've seen in photos that Jim worked at. Like,
yeah.
And all this stuff, and you're just like, oh my gosh, they're working on the Cat in the Hat TV show.
They're working on the Cat in the Hat TV show. This was right around the Disney acquisition, I think, had happened, and there was a lot of fallout from that, and they were kind of trying to figure out a way to move forward. They were in a real transitionary. They've been in a transitionary period for many, many years. There's so many talented people. To Bill's note, there was a lot of Jim Henson. Then there is a lot of Jim Hensons that work for Jim Henson. And I feel like in some ways, for many years, they were like sheep without a shepherd. And I feel like now they're really starting to do stuff again. And I'm so happy and excited for them that they are. But that advice changed my trajectory. It really did.
And to hear those words from someone like a hero of yours.
A hero who had worked for all those people. All of them. He had worked for all of them.
Right? You're right. He worked for everything. He worked
for Disney. He worked on the Disney Dinosaur movie. He had worked on Jim Henson.
And that was the thing. I remember it specifically. I remember him standing at this very table. This table, you had this light table, and next to it was the file cabinet, and he was going through all the files. You were pulling them all out and showing him the files.
Yeah.
And I think what happened was he saw... He
probably saw himself.
I think he saw himself, and I think he saw just the breadth of your work, like of everything that you were making. And then you open a closet, and it's filled with puppets, and I think he saw... an imagination beyond just designing characters for someone else who's...
Yeah. Or he just thought they'll suck them dry, which happens to some. Some artists can't, you know, they will run. Some artists can thrive in it. And many of them I admire and have books on and know as friends. Like Ian, you know, I feel like many of the conversations, Ian McKeag had hopped on here early on, and Ian's done... so much terrific concept art, and he's such an unbelievable artist. I wish I could draw at the level Ian draws. Many times, you know, the conversations I have with Ian, he doesn't want to talk about his movies that he's worked on, and he's worked on for everybody and on everything. He wants to talk about books. You know, he's got this longing to do, you know, books. And even... people that I know in animation that I've met and gotten to know along the way that are like, oh my God, you know, and I'm like, tell me about how you give the illusion of life. How do you make a drawing act and make it move? And they're like, how do you get a children's book published?
Well, I think that there's something really interesting like a mutual... for someone who works on a collaborative experience, like a film. And when you see your name, like how many people would just give their, you know, right hand to, like, go work on a film?
Sure.
And then, you know, for those people who it becomes regular hat for, and we know many of those people, you know, your name is scrolled by in seconds. So the idea of having a book
with your name on the front,
I think is really enticing and exciting for a sure. lot of artists.
All right, Ange Para.
Yeah, you're right. Don Bluth's story. I mean, Don Bluth breaking off from Disney, right?
Yes. Although, depending on who you asked, that didn't go over. I think there was a lot of hard feelings mm-hmm. when Don left. I don't know all the details. I'm sure you can Google it. I'm sure there's articles out there. I've watched little tidbits and snippets. And oh, wait. It's also on Disney Plus. Waking Sleeping Beauty
yep.
is a terrific documentary about that exodus led by Don Bluth. And the fallout from where Disney was really languishing in the 80s. And again, those of us old enough to remember The Sword and the Stone and some of the other ill-fated features that were out at that time, that was all tied into a big exodus and a turnover at their high-up level.
Let's see.
Should we do one more dinosaur, Ange?
Do you know Jim Gurney personally? He's an amazing artist with Dinotopia.
We do know Jim Gurney personally, and yes, he is an unbelievable artist. And I haven't spoken to him in a while. I love that he's kind of become this teacher for many. I mean, his stuff he's done online with his plein air painting is pretty terrific. And he understands color like a master. Again, I've mentioned him a few times. But yeah, I've known Jim. And as a matter of fact, we were talking about Dinosaur Summer. I think we got Jim to do a blurb for Dinosaur Summer.
He was another artist that we met when we pretty early on, when we moved to New York, after we met.
Right, he invited us.
Mike Kaluta. Michael Kaluta. And Mike had invited us, actually, to his, Jim Gurney used to do like a kind of hangout, artist hangout, get together. I think every summer he would.
This I can elaborate on. It was called First Fridays.
There you go.
And it was started in the 70s when there was a whole group of, well, and there still was, of artists living up in the Rhinebeck area, which is where Jim is. He's in upstate New York. So these artists would include Bernie Wrightson,
Eduardo Cabruja said, Tony, make your own dino.
Oh, all right. Stop drawing the real ones.
Anyone can do that. Draw your own.
All right.
Ooh, you put away the books.
I like put that. Everything away. And I'll just draw for
ask
you.
Ask and you shall receive, Eduardo Lozada Cabruja.
Yes, you will. I like, there's a bird called a skimmer, Ange.
No, we've never been to a lexicon.
No, we've been asked many, many times to go. Patrick, who runs that, has been very, very kind in inviting me over and over many years to do it. And every year I go, oh, I really want to go, and then I just don't. Because it's always in the fall, and the fall is one of our busiest times. If it's not busy enough with Soph going to school.
It's usually tour. I want to say
it's like, we're on tour or deadline, and it's just, and we don't do conventions anymore. And it's a convention where you set up and you're selling prints and original artwork, and we don't really, we'll prep for that like when we did Gen Con 5 years ago or Luca 4 years ago, but otherwise no, that's why we don't do it. It's just I don't have the capacity to prep for a thing like that, but who knows, maybe in the, you know, maybe that'll change.
I don't know.
How
are we gonna be?
I don't know.
What does the future look like?
I actually, we were supposed to go to San Diego this year, and
I'm so sad.
And we just got
so bummed that yeah. San Diego Comic Con.
Virtual. It's gone virtual, yeah. Oh,
such a bummer. I mean, we love going to Comic Con so much because
we get to tell Bill Stout how awesome
he is. We get to hang out with Bill Stout every time we sit down, and I'm like, Bill Stout, do you remember when you said that to Tony?
Thank you.
Because we're super fans. We're total fanboy and fangirl, too. So we get to go and hang out and geek out and buy things. and see all of our friends. One of our most awesome experiences at Comic-Con is we always have like a great dinner with some super awesome people at the Hotel Del Coronado, and then you get some good celebrity sighting. A couple times ago, we had like the entire cast of Walking Dead sitting at the table right behind us. That was pretty cool.
Yeah. I wasn't watching the show. We weren't watching the show, so we didn't really know who they were, but
I knew who it was.
Everybody else was freaking out.
That scroungy looking guy that everybody liked.
Oh, yeah. Anyway, the first Fridays was
we dress up when we go to cons. We don't dress up at the cons.
Nerd.
We dress up for Ren Fairs.
Oh, yeah.
But we don't dress up at the cons. We kind of go in business mode a little bit.
Yeah.
We're worky.
Yeah.
You got to go to work parties and stuff like that.
Yeah. I'm just kind of drawing a feathered theropod dinosaur, Ange. And then I'll tell the first Friday story and before we call it a day.
Yeah.
So, yeah, the first Fridays, and it was Jeff Jones and Mike Kaluta, Stephen Hickman, Ralph Bakshi. There's a ton of artists in that area, and they all get together. And so Jim Gurney decided to continue the tradition at some point in the like late 90s. And he would do it like once a year. He would just basically do a big, giant barbecue, you know, just a bunch of artists getting together. And of course, Michael Kaluta was invited, and Kaluta asked if we wanted to join him. And we said, Angie and I said, sure. So we rented a car. We were living in Brooklyn. And we rented a car. And
We got to go hang out at Kaluta's house, which was awesome.
Yeah, we'd known Mike we met him really early on when we moved to New York City. And we became fast friends just had a terrific time getting to know. He's just such a sweet man and just another incredible inspiration. And
one thing I was noticed, too, is that all of these artists like Kaluta and Jim Gurney and Bill Stout were all very familiar with young artists and all super excited by young artists, which I thought was super cool.
Yeah, they were very aware of what, and I try to be. I try to follow in that. It's a little harder now because with the internet, there's just so many young artists. But I try, you know, and you've seen my Instagram feed. I follow quite a few young artists and want to know who they are and encourage them and so on and so forth, just like some of the ones listening today. The first time we went, we met everybody. Ralph Bakshi was there, and we met him, and we got along terrifically.
Yeah, I love Ralph Bakshi.
Oh, my gosh. He was such just a funny guy. Ralph did a bunch of movies. Most of them your kids can't watch.
Well, the other thing is, growing up in Florida, I mean, I was a makeup artist at the time, and you being an artist, I didn't know a lot of people who did what we did.
Yeah.
I didn't know a lot. We didn't know a lot of other artists.
Yeah.
You know, so when we moved to New York City, I feel like that was really the first time when we started becoming immersed into a community
of other artists. Yeah, that's when I start. I mean, I was going life drawing with Donato Giancola once a week, and you'd bump into artists that when they would come into town and try to see them, and you know, Scott Fisher and Pete DeSev and some of these. Doug Gregory was living there. And so it was a great time. It was a really great time. And
Eduardo wants to know if this is a carnival.
I think so. It's looking like it, huh? I'm also thinking it's got proto wings like a terror bird, but maybe it's got claws.
Jubal Gordon said, "Why can't the kids watch them? Those were the best movies to watch as a kid."
Oh my God, that's funny. Like Wizards and Fritz the Cat. He did the one Lord of the Rings version.
Do you have any ideas for people who want to gain such immersion now? That's a good question, Charity. I feel like, it's changed, right? Because a lot of people, now it's virtual. We're doing it right now. And I feel like, I don't know if there's a lot of other artists hang out. I mean, I know we have hangouts, like, you know, our friend Mo Willems has a great gathering on New Year's Day, and you know, we have friends over from stuff for stuff, and you know, there's
we tried to do it one year.
We were gonna have.
There were so many people coming.
We had rented a tent. It was going to be an barbecue, so it was an art-themed barbecue. We were going to line all the tables with, like, butcher paper and rolls of drawing paper. And I bought tons of art supplies, and they were just going to be all over the tables.
And we had it catered. We had gone to a local barbecue place that was going to cater it, so we didn't have to think about catering it. And we had people coming in from New York City and
oh my gosh, pretty, people came in from everywhere.
Yeah, and then
Joe Suffin
drove here from
our
from
friends came from Pennsylvania.
Yeah, like, and then I remember again, like we do with everything, we kind of threw.
She just said it.
The Articue, remember that, Heidi? And then out of the blue, kind of out of the blue, we get a hurricane in Massachusetts. And it was, everybody was like, they're closing roads, they're closing everything. And we thought the weather's going to be horrible. And it was.
And it was. And we had people that were already here for it. So then we had a house filled with people who had come
for the Articue. And it was, and we never did it after that. We were always going to like talk about doing it. And I think that just.
Well, because we also spend a Florida time. We hang out in Florida. Yeah. We're going to do it in the summer.
Yeah.
At the end of the summer.
Yeah.
And so we ended up not doing it. It was such a bummer.
Yeah, we should have done it. We should do it.
I know.
Life's too short. You should do it. I mean, once everything gets back to normal.
We used to have parties all the time. Actually, we used to, every time Tony finished a picture book, we had a party for it. So we would have a party where Tony would show all of the original artwork. I love to entertain. We still do have people over.
Yeah, it's been a while.
When we could, right?
Yeah, yeah. It's been a while though, right?
Yeah. Now it's usually around, we have everybody over for Thanksgiving, like holidays. Yeah. Stuff more.
We're so busy now.
Yeah.
That's what really happened too. We just got so busy that the thought of planning it, you know. But, you know, look, Jim Gurney was in the middle of Dinotopia and he still found time to do it. Those friendships, I mean, especially now, it kind of puts a, be able to meet with kindred spirits, even if you're not like your diehard friend, but the idea of sharing that, you just never know. It's just
Tony's not making a roast, Dean. He doesn't cook.
I don't cook, I clean, I do all the dishes.
He does all the dishes. He is a master dishwasher.
Heidi will tell you. She's experienced it firsthand.
Yes. We actually have a friend, Dr. Chris Rose, who loves to watch Tony do the dishes because it's so soothing. Like, it's just hanging out, and he's so very thorough. Take care of everything.
Whatever. I like it. I find it calming. It feels good on my hands, too. And I use pretty hot water.
Yeah, I mean, when we celebrate the wedding, Alfonso and Dorothy, then I think
another
Articue should definitely be, there should be an Articue. I mean, you probably want your reception to be a little bit more formal than a barbecue. But we could do a Friday Articue, and then, you know, have the... We could have our own party, because I'm sure you're going to want to do stuff with your family.
This is a Detro Raptor, Ange.
Ooh, it's a Detro Raptor. It.
There you go. You asked, and I have produced. And that, my friends, has been a... It's really been a dino draw by request. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Ange, let's figure out not only a person who's going to win some dinosaur drawings...
Dang.
But also, what we want to do next week. We'll have to think about it. We'll figure it out. If you guys have any suggestions, let us know what day you think works better. If Friday works better than not.
Let's see. I think I have a name here. I just got to go make sure.
Oh, and then Junk Pot winner. Yes.
This person has not won. I'm very excited.
All right. Let me know when you're ready and you cue up the music and then we'll get the Junk Pot winner ready.
Okay.
Who is our Junk Pot winner today? Ready?
Okay, hold on. Let me get the music cued.
And I'll do the drum roll.
Oh, man. You know what? I'm so bummed.
Why?
Hold on. I'll tell you why. Because the whole time, and I forgot to turn it on.
You had dinosaur music?
I had dinosaur music ready to go.
Oh.
I was ready to go, and I forgot to press play because I didn't want to put on too early.
It's okay.
So instead of the Drawn to Fantasy, I think I'm going to have this on.
This is Jurassic Park? Nice.
Okay. Okay.
So all right. So you
got this out with some Jurassic.
All right. And do you have a winner?
I like this.
Dorothy wants to know if this is our last junk pot. No, Dorothy. We'll continue the junk pots. I would never stop.
You know what? We will not consider that. Like, are we going to do? Will we be here on Monday?
I don't know. Will we? We're here. It's Slurs Day. We're here every day.
Oh, my goodness.
We'll send a note. We'll let you guys know. We'll let you know.
We'll do the countdown.
Yes. You can tell we don't have our act quite together on it. We're thinking about it. But in the meantime, who is our Junk Pot winner?
Okay, today's Junk Pot winner is Tony... Nadine Catapane Fagan!
Nadine! Yes, Nadine.
The winner today.
As she should be. She's been a longtime fan for Nadine. Nadine, you're getting Dinosaurs. I hope you're
a dinosaur fan, Nadine.
I'll get this. Nadine, just shoot me a direct message with your snail mail address, and I'll put it in the mail for you tomorrow. I hope you guys are doing fine. Have a terrific weekend. Stay safe, stay healthy. We'll check in with you next week and let you know what days we're going to go live. And until then,
congratulations
to Nadine.
Hang in there. You guys have a great weekend.
Yeah, the weather's beautiful. We've got a beautiful day here, so I think we're going to go out and enjoy that this weekend.
Draw a dinosaur for your homework if you feel like drawing.
Bye.
Bye, guys.